Poland in there. Got him. Sweet. All right, cool. So we'll continue on. You know, feel free to mess around with the Envision freehand as well. I think we'll grab some more screenshots and we'll share with the community afterwards. But we're gonna go and get started. We firstly, I'm gonna bring in Felix Lee, one of my favorite people in the world, to make a community announcement. Felix?
All right, thank you, Casey. You're one of my favorite as well. I just want to make sure that everyone can hear me. If you can, just give me a thumbs up. All right, awesome. Thank you guys for joining this morning and, you know, some of you this evening, afternoon, I reckon for some people as well. My name is Felix. I'm one of the co-founders at ADPList. So I really appreciate all of you for tuning in almost every session. I kind of almost feel like, you know, coffee hours and after hours are always like a mystery box. I tell the team, you know, you never know what you're going to find here, but it's just full of knowledge. It's just full of fun and you just meet new people. And that's kind of the way that our community is built upon, right? Really an open and inclusive community over the past 9 months that we have started and it's grown tremendously. So, you know, thank you all for being a part of this, right? As, you know, last year in December, I actually reflected quite a bit and, you know, I wrote a letter. So I can't wait to share with all of you later this week, and I'll share with you about some of the updates that we have been working on. But for that, I would like to thank every one of you for staying through together for the past 9 months. And you know, we look forward to an amazing year with everyone. And today I just kind of want to make an announcement that, you know, if you have a mentor or you have a friend that helped you through last year or even like early this year, just, you know, you're just a 7 days in, you know, do write them a review on ADPList, write your mentors a review. That would really go a long way to helping us to build a trusted and safe community where all of us can feel safe to connect with someone and all of us can feel like we belong somewhere in this community. So yeah, just want to shout out to the mentors who are doing an amazing job and the designers and the mentees who are actively writing reviews and meeting people around the world. That has been amazing, amazing. Yeah, so let's keep up the amazing connections and I can't wait to meet some of you in the coming months as well. Yeah, back to you, Casey.
Thank you, Felix. Always a pleasure. Moving forward, we're gonna have our mentors for the portfolio review tonight come off mute and tell us who they are. They're, you know, your name, give us a Twitter-esque shortened version of your life and what you do. And we've got James Robinson and Jacqueline Ding. Feel free to jump in.
Jacqueline, would you like to go first? Should I go first? I'll go first.
You're already here, James.
I'll go first. I'm already here. Hey, guys. I'm James. I'm in New York City and from New York City. Thank you so much for being here. I am a lead product designer at Proxy, a Series B startup, transforming the way, I guess, that you could, we all interact with the spaces around us. Go to proxy.com, learn more about it. Super cool. I also lead strategic partnerships here at ADPList and mentor in this amazing community. Thank you so much for being here. I'm super excited.
Thanks, James, and thanks, Casey. Hi, I'm Jacqueline, and I'm based in Sydney, Australia. It's so good to see everyone. Choose to be here, choose to be supporting each other here today. You are my inspirations. So I've been doing product design for the last 9-10 years, and before that, I spent maybe like 5 years doing branding design, branding strategies. And so it has been a long journey. 2 years ago, I started to coach and teach user experience, and I'm stepping into the consulting for business as well, mainly training the teams and putting systems in place. Currently, I'm heading design at a startup called Hoteller in Sydney, Australia. Just helping them to build an MVP and validating product market fit. And welcome to be here. So excited for the next hour.
Excellent. Well, thank you for introducing yourselves. Everybody on the call, let's give a quiet round of applause for our mentors joining us tonight. Yeah. And then give us another quiet round of applause for ADPList and the community team here putting this on. Absolutely. Excellent. Fantastic. So what's going to happen now is that everybody on the call, put your portfolio in the chat and then we're going to choose them by random. And you know what? Let's start off with Jacqueline. Jacqueline, I feel like, you know, you pick one and then James, you're next and you guys bounce back and forth, have conversation, have fun with it. You know, the whole spiel. And then, of course, obviously share your screen, please, so we can see what you're looking at, what you're thinking.
Right. Okay. Wow. I was trying to click on the first link, and before I even did that, I think it jumped about 55 links. So I'm not quite sure what's happening. Just whatever random comes up. So I guess, guys, you've got to just really sell it if you really want it to get reviewed. Can you guys see my screen? Yep. Okay. Great. I've got two screens, so I'm like not looking at the camera at the moment, but hope that's okay. Right. So Hannah. Hi, Hannah. Great introduction. I actually personally, and some of these comments I make, it's going to be a little bit more like personal preferences. Personally, I like to see people's face because you need to imagine this is your personal showroom, right? You want to get your personality across a little bit. Passion, yep, great. Here is some sort of like screenshots. I'm just going to click into the first one. Yeah, and I guess usually the first one, whatever you choose to feature on your portfolio should be the one that you absolutely love. If any of those work that you are like, not quite sure about, I would say just leave it out. But I'm assuming the first one is definitely the one that you're most proud of. Cool, overview, great. I love, definitely great idea to have like a good sort of header image to demonstrate what's the final look and feel it's like, because that kind of gives me an expectation of what to what's to come as I scroll. Little description of the timeline, team, it's good. Toronto based, introduction is good, short, problems, yay. Okay, so what I really love, this is fantastic, is that it's scannable, right? There is a big heading here. So basically, I can guarantee you 90% of the time recruitment recruiters are not going to read the body copy. So make sure, if you can have one challenge that you're going to throw to yourself, is that can you actually tell the story by headings, information architecture, hierarchy? Yeah, cool. For the scannability purpose, sometimes I would make the headings a sentence. So it kind of describes exactly what you're saying here in a short form. So for example, information architecture, it's messy, or like user cannot find information within the current sitemap. Yeah. Great. Okay. Solution preview. All right. So this is like your final prototype sort of thing. I'm sort of imagining, let me just go. Okay. Visual design. So this is where what we're focusing on is a little bit of research and visual design. Okay. Easily accessible to frequently used sessions and thoughtful. Yep. Really nice, clean information laid out here without me going into too much detail of the reading. And meet our users, cool. Pinpoints, is good. I would be curious to know that how did you find the users? Is this an existing client that they provided you with a list of users to approach, or if this is particular one of the user type and how many users that you have interviews, sort of like a summary, maybe perhaps you've spoken to 10 users and you finalize that all of the 10 users share these type of pinpoints, and that's the persona. Initial sketches. Okay, cool. Sometimes I think initial sketches is it's a good little sort of icebreaker thing, because it kind of shows you are capable of picking up a pencil and pen and just like sketch it away. But it's not essential that you have to include in every single case study. Meet your vibe. Usability testing, okay. So you have labeled out what needs to be updated and changed in the first prototype. Cool, but all of this actually is unreadable for me at the moment. I'm not quite sure it's probably not important for me to read it. I just wanted to see how you actually went ahead and do the usability testing. How many people did you test? How did you document the patterns that you found from the testing? Meet the new vibe. Okay. Recommend based on mood. Okay. Interesting. It's a great idea, actually. So obviously, because of the time of like 10 minutes when people are scrolling, they're probably not going to be able to read through and sit through every single one. But basically, what I'm seeing here is that you have a really good eye for hierarchies in terms of visual design. But watch out for accessibility here, color contrast and accessibility. It's probably one of the, you know, white text on gradient background. Is it readable? This text, sizing of the text for particular phone screens, is that going to be readable? Is it big enough? Okay, reflection is always a great thing to include. Future of the project. Yeah, so sometimes in the reflection part, it's really good to see what you would have done differently and if there's anything in the process that you wish you have changed or done it differently to get a different result. James, would you like to add anything?
No, I think you got a lot of it. I would jump in on the personas in particular. So those who have been on any kind of mentoring session with me will know that I like to pick on this because this is a common mistake, I think. A lot of the time, personas end up having more data than we can support. Sorry, more information there than we can support with data. For example, we have here these like pleasure points and stuff, pain points. We have like a full-time project manager. Yet we are making a lot of assumptions about this person. This person is male. This person is white. This person is young. This person is all these other kind of things. And this leads us into biases. Now, I think that there's a real advantage to showing those kind of personas in the sense that it is validating, right? If we view it towards the end, having designed a solution, then compare it to our persona and be like, would this persona, who I have an intuitive understanding of, would this persona have use for what we designed? Then that's great. But if we're using it on the other end of the thing, from an ideation standpoint, we run a risk of assuming that everything about the persona is indeed data-backed, right? So in this case, that we are designing for someone who's male, and we may not have data to support that. So one of the big things that I am always looking for, if I'm in any kind of hiring conversation, is to specifically ask, when it comes to these kind of personas, what about this is actually data-based? And what about it is an assumption? Or a common question I'll ask is like, what are the limitations of personas? What biases might we run into here? So a good designer is able to articulate when those kind of biases exist. And I think it's probably one of the biggest pitfalls that we've run into.
Yeah, love it. Great. And actually, while James is talking, I actually thought about another thing that's really important in any portfolio. Is that every single method that you choose to proceed with, right? For example, you have chosen, this is the summary of your research, but what about the process? I mean, how many people did you decide to interview or get the data sets from? Where did you find them? How did you interview them? What's the method that you used there? I think those are the thinking behind that behind all of those processes leads us to this finalized persona point. That's important. And that would give you the opportunity to include what James mentioned, those data sets, where is it coming from? Are they assumptions? Are they realistic data? Are they from big data sets, for example? Ideation, how do we get into the ideation? So I guess what I'm saying here is every single part of this process, it's of course crucial, right? But the most important part is how this piece of information leads to the next piece of information. What's that connection there? So I'm looking for the thread, that connecting between every single methodology that you chose. I'm looking for that, maybe even like a little insight summary in between. So it needs like to be a connection. It's like a necklace, really. Otherwise, it's loose pieces of jewelry that it doesn't connect. I don't know if you agree, James.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a question of like just narrative, right? There's, I think, a tendency for people to think to themselves like, oh, I need to make everything connect. Like I see this problem occur in the other direction where people are, they want to see all of those, you know, things in this exact same kind of way, but that can sort of lead to a monotony. What I think you're mentioning, Jacqueline, is that like the same thought needs to be connected. And so what I sometimes like to do, because in reality, a lot of design solutions have several mini stories within them, is to kind of have that kind of alignment or cohesion indicate to me when I have completed one of these sub-stories and when I've moved on to the next. I was referencing in a mentoring session recently that I once worked on this thing where there was a sidebar and then there was like some main content. And you know, I would get feedback on occasion that like the stuff in the sidebar didn't line up with the main content. But what I kept saying is that's intentional, because alignment makes you think that you have you have connection between those, when in fact these were completely separate elements. We don't want to create that alignment in some cases. So I sometimes like how we can use cohesion in a storyline or visual metaphors to indicate when we have like one mentality, one mindset, one story versus when we transition to another.
Yeah, love it. And then actually, I think Lehenna, you've got a really good idea to include more of a detailed full case study link where this is where I can click into to find more information. Great. Cool. I really like that. So probably we don't have time to go through every single page on this particular PDF, but just based on, you know, the few scroll, I think definitely that's the right track. So for those of you who has a like huge amount of information that you can't fit, or it's not fit, but it's more like, you know, you want to make sure that your case study is clean, you can always include a call to action link that takes the viewer, if they willing to find out more about your process, to see how you get to your final decisions on your case study. Cool. All right. Is it 10 minutes? I don't even know. Oh my God, I forgot to press start.
Can I quickly jump in on that point? I like that we have a PDF here. There are a lot of cases in which, for various technical limitations, jobs like you to be able to show that case study in a sort of slide deck. And this just makes it super easy for us to do. One thing I would caution about, though, is the sense that there's a tendency maybe, and I fall into this all the time, where I think to myself, if I've put the information on there somewhere, then I can sleep easy knowing that that information is out there, right? That information, that context is part of the whole study. And what I think that we end up having is a realization that it's harder in many cases to edit, to limit, to make things smaller. And so something I tend to watch for with like all of these different, you know, case studies, and now I link to a lengthy PDF and everything like that, is that does this sort of serve to abdicate our responsibility to make choices, to know what the most impactful things are? It can almost be more impactful to show less. So just keep that in mind.
Yeah, absolutely agree, 100%. That is Hannah's. Well done, Hannah. Congratulations.
Cool.
James, you well go. Done,
awesome. So I've been looking as Jacqueline, you've been talking, and I found one here. Congratulations, Claire Kim. You were the lucky winner. Let us take a look. Cool. So firstly, off the bat, I really love the immersive nature of this thing, right? You see a whole lot of things that are just like, you know, you arrive at a page and you have a whole bunch of things. This is kind of cool. Like, oh, wave my hands. Okay, sure. Wait a minute. Oh, nice to meet you. That's fun. So like, you know, this is kind of cool at times. And I think that it's nice that I'm forced to really engage with who this person is and what's going on here. Marketer turned product designer in San Francisco who understands how design can better shape technology and push the business forward. These statements are surprisingly difficult to write. You know, I've struggled a lot with just trying to condense who I am as a designer into like one easy soundbite like this. And this one I think is fairly distinctive. It doesn't say that you're just passionate about amazing experiences. It talks about more specifically about like, you know, how it's about technology and stuff. But, you know, I would wonder if perhaps there's an opportunity to make this even more impactful. Proofs at IBM, currently designing a project ENT and seeking new graduate product designer opportunities. That's great too. Very rarely is it immediately apparent who this kind of person is, what their seniority level is, what kind of thing that they're looking for. So like, that's a cool thing off the bat, particularly for recruiters who are often not very knowledgeable about design. This lets them say, this person is in line with the seniority level that I would need, and I can quickly pass them off to the next level. So that can be kind of nice. I scroll here. We have all the stuff come in. We have a good number of different cases with like unique branding for each of them too. That's something else I really like as well. You know, like this thing, like each one of these things is pretty engaging. And frequently I think people can forget this step. They don't like, you know, show logo and stuff. Here we have a pretty engaging thumbnail for each that I'm excited to read about. I've opened a few to just show a couple of things that were sending out to me. Firstly, this Notion one. So while some of them go into a thing to do with the, you know, in the website, like this one, for example, which we'll get back to, this one here opens up in a Medium article. I really like this. So like, you know, the saying is done is better than perfect. And what often happens is you end up with this like decision paralysis of sorts where you say to yourself, oh, my lengthy case study like isn't done. I need to have like this fancy tool. I need to like customize how it appears in Squarespace. And sometimes you just need to tell a story. And what better way to tell a story than just with narrative storytelling like this? So I am totally up for people showing things in a Figma or people showing things in a Medium article or whatever else is required so that we can just show what it is we're working on here, much more like it's almost like a blog post. So cool. Anyway, it also, I think, feels like, you know, it's more natural for sort of these kind of longer form content stuff. We have all this overview and all that, and then observation. That's cool, but I want to reiterate, I think, something that Jacqueline was alluding to earlier as well, which is that people need to understand the story from headlines, or they need to understand it from like a pretty high level. Here, I am required to read this in order to understand really what's going on. That isn't necessarily objectionable. I mean, like, we're not talking about a crazy amount of content here. But I'd love to explore how potentially larger text here can provide me some basic bullet points about what's going on. Here, we start at a really high level, right, about like the whole story of Notion and stuff. Perhaps there's a way that we could jump more directly into the opportunity that we've identified. So we set expectations, set a thesis statement up front, almost more like a sort of scientific paper where there's an abstract and we just say the story, instead of something that's a bit more narrative based, wherein this is an introduction. So we go through all the stuff. That's really cool. I like how we have like, you know, images and stuff, but at the same time, these images aren't accessible. I mean, I can jump into them, which is nice. But you know, otherwise I can't read what's going on here. Simple guidance page on how to get started. Okay, cool. That makes sense to me. Then we have here, like, see, this is exactly what I'm talking about. I love this. Like, we call it a hypothesis. A certain number of onboarding screens help overcome the initial learning curve and ease users into the app. We have this proposed approach, and we add screens in here. All of this, I think, is clear, and it makes it apparent to me what the intervention proposed is. I'm a little unclear, though, that we're even talking about the onboarding case. Like, I understand we had the hypothesis here, but it could be the case that we had more of a setting expectations, as I was saying a little bit earlier. But anyway. Then we sort of jumped into this. Not 100% sure what this is. I see. We have like a little sort of walkthrough. This is much more apparent to me because it shows the context in which it appears, which I really like. Here, it's unclear to me how we arrive here. Maybe this is like a full page. We don't really know. But here, it's more apparent that this is like a bit of a walkthrough that appears in the context of everything else. I like that. While I understand that we are recording and all, I always am struck by what an impact it can have when you present content in the most, you know, in like, you know, professional looking mockups and stuff. Here we have like all of your minimized windows and stuff. And this is such a minor thing, but it speaks to overall polish, and we might have a higher impact if we might be able to present it in a way that feels like we're part of this, like more, I don't know, perhaps a more immersive experience. But at the same time, I like how it's really focused in this kind of process work where it's really linked to the, you know, it's your computer. It's actually functional. That's awesome. So I really like all this stuff. And then we sort of go through again, hypothesis here as well. And we have like each of these like mini studies within it with like divider lines. I think that that can overall be effective, but sometimes there's a concern when we have these serial kind of format that we never arrive at a full solution. Are all of these going to collect into one giant thing at the end? Or is it going to be the kind of thing where each one of these things was a minor intervention, like a sort of smaller intervention that it got its own benefit that in the aggregate presents a major change? Here we keep sort of jumping into these hypotheses. I'm not sure what the outcome of this was, if any. I understand at the very top here, we have a description that this is like just driven by personal interests. And so perhaps this was never deployed, so we can't determine an outcome. But there are ways we can still assess outcome, like for example, by putting this in front of our friends, just asking for that kind of feedback. We can almost fake a deployment in that way, which I really like to see sometimes. Anyway, so that's the whole thing with this Notion one. I really like how that's there. But then I wanted to talk about this one as well. I like how this, particularly for a more visual solution, the other one's maybe a bit more interaction or strategy based. This one is really kind of simple and immersive. I think that the visual style here is really nice. I really like this. The map is here and all that stuff I think is really cool. I would pay attention though to the way, how robust of a project this feels. And I think that there's a potential that, I mean, yes, it was one asset and all, but we could show it in context perhaps a little bit more, or even if it wasn't part of the actual scope of what was really the work, we can expand the application of the brand like direction here to include, I don't know, like maybe save the dates. It could be things day of, even if they weren't actually deployed, it can show how it would be part of an overall system. I tend to like when that kind of thing happens. This is also just a tiny gripe that I want to just point out as we go. Full width text. I think that this is harder to read than it would ideally be. I pulled up over here the New York Times, not to remind everyone of that, but do you notice how the text is indented relative to images? The text here, I would guess, if we were to count the lines, is around 60-something characters. And what I want to illustrate is that there's an ideal width for easy readability. Conveniently, Medium does this automatically. If we go to like these Medium ones, we see all of this kind of text at this overall width. And while these images are not as full width as the ones like the New York Times, we still do have like a readability there that in cases like this, maybe we're sacrificing slightly. And if we were to make it a bit smaller, the thing would be longer and perhaps it would feel a bit more robust. But overall, I think that this is really a cool thing. And I love how branded the thing feels. It feels like this designer is both visually competent with these projects, but then also has this like interaction strategic approach with a real grounding in technology, which I really like. All of that makes a lot of sense to me. And these things are implemented in this clean, straightforward way with standardized description of timeline, role, and all of this stuff as well. This in particular is kind of fun. Reserve meals. And so it's like a walkthrough, which I really like. And we have almost a more iconographic solution to calling out individual points here. Jacqueline, any thoughts I'm missing on these?
I absolutely think this is a great, like really good example it's really easy for me to browse through the information on this particular example you've picked. The one thing that I'm always a bit, like I love that intro page and the little intro interactions, but is that I think it's probably just me. I'm a little bit like too anal in terms of like thin text on thin white text on color background, because that's often just really hard to read for most people. And if they find it hard, guess what happened? They don't read it. So I probably would just increase the type weight by like, I don't know, 1 point up or something. Yeah,
no, I completely agree. I think one of the tough things about design is that you're expected, particularly design for technology, is that you're expected to be good at like everything. And that's a reasonable expectation in some ways, because our jobs require us to be good at everything. Here, we're doing visual work, so we are judged on visual grounds, but also we're judged on really strategic, businessy kind of design as well. We're judged on interaction. We're judged on knowing technologies. We're judged in just this presentation. And those things in, all in combination, I think, can be really a challenge to do effectively. The comments I think that we've been making so far in these last two have been around presentation mostly. For future ones that I'll pick, I'm gonna try to focus more on the cases themselves, but I wanna just touch a little briefly on just things about like screens in particular. I think it's valuable sometimes to provide context as to why or how we are to judge what we're seeing here. Was this a process work? It's occurring kind of in the middle here, maybe along with sort of process stuff, prior even to process stuff. Is this a final solution? It can help to articulate that. I'd also point out too then that that helps set expectations on, as I said, the very many things that you're judged on. So, you know, you may be judged visually, but then also on interaction. Perhaps the purpose of this is to explore some basic interaction opportunities. If so, we may not object to the fact that we have this sort of conflict going on between the X up here and the back that's in the field behind it. Otherwise, I might say perhaps this X could be more closely linked to the noodle at hand. I'm really nitpicking there, but just as an example, that may not be something that you intend to be the conversation. And I don't think it is what you intend to be the conversation, because here we have stuff that's more, I think, just product-based. I do like, too, how we are doing this kind of thinking. And I think from a process standpoint, at least it shows that you have been thinking about it. But again, I would note that this is not accessible content. Just like a lot of process work that we see, where it's like little sketches and stuff, there is no way I could glean anything here other than the fact that you've made a chart, which is, again, fine. And I'm being kind of harsh here, but you sort of see what I'm illustrating. This, in contrast, you can see and can understand, of course, with the small exception of what Jacqueline was saying about how we can make this type more accessible. Mm-hmm. So, awesome.
We're gonna jump in real quick, and I think that's time. Let's move on to the next one.
Cool. All right, stay tuned. Who's the lucky next? It's really hard to pick, guys. I have picked Rob's. This is, you know, after I went through like a couple of, I was like, okay, well, what can I talk about? What can I deliver value through picking an example? I'm just going to go ahead and click into Rob's first case study. And I think there's a couple of points here that I've seen similar portfolios going around, and it's worth to point out. First things first, fantastic that you have a Figma prototype, which is great. My personal advice is make it an external link. So when I click it, it will actually open up a new window. So I don't, you know, as a viewer, I don't get taken away from your original portfolio. But watch out on the image qualities, because I think most monitors, but I am using a big cinema display. This is looking pixelated on my screen. But what I really like about this is one thing that every single designer could utilize. It's don't be afraid to use bold within a sentence, because as I'm scanning through all of this information, what I'm reading is overview. And then the next thing I choose to read probably is, you know, make sure that the stuff that you highlight is the most key point that you wanted to offer a full service. Okay, cool. What define full range service, I guess. So I personally think this part of information is the most important information, because that kind of indicates whether or not the rest of this case study is worth it for me to spend time scrolling through. Sometimes going back to the previous case study James pulled out, which obviously is on the more intermediate side. And I think if you are more on the more intermediate level designers, you may want to consider not just describing your project, but give me an impact statement of what happened after you designed this product or designed this feature. What happened? What difference did it make to the business? What difference did it make to the user? If you have the opportunity to go through the proper usability testings and analyzing, aligning it with business goals. Those would be like some of the most impactful statement to have if you can access to them. Timeline, great. Figma, role UX, cool. I wonder, and another thing would be good to, for me, I always am curious to find out if this person is solo working through this entire project, what kind of, is this a bootcamp project? I also think it's worth it to mention if this is a bootcamp project, you know, don't be afraid to hide it. The key is, you know, you just do more of it. But to be honest, just like be transparent about if this is a team project, if this is a bootcamp or it's a hackathon, etc. Research. Okay, so that's what we've done. Again, I'm sure you guys already know by now that nobody's going to go through reading. Maybe I'll just like up to that point is where everyone's going to read, right? So utilize point forms. Don't be afraid to use point forms. Don't be afraid to pull out quotes, etc. Competitor, great. You've done some competitor research, but where does the product sit within the competitor's spectrum? That's where I want to see, because, you know, don't be afraid to maybe just have some sort of like a summary, insight summary after the competitive analysis. Maybe the insight is this product that I'm designing compared to the rest of the competitor, that's how we could, you know, we could, there is a space where the opportunity lays that the user needs, etc. Okay, so in here, it's good idea always I think it's always nice to, for me to know, you know, if the designer has considered how many users that they're going to interview, age range, gender, and why, because in most business cases, the, you know, the amount of users that you decided to interview and the different ways that you interview them, it's sort of like a crucial decision point, because you need to be making sure that the decision that you made to these participants, you are making sure that you're covering the wide range as well as not being biased. And and I think, you know, sometimes it's good for you to pull out these numbers and then make it more almost like an infographic kind of representation to summarize that data. Great. Fantastic. 94% uses them, these apps here. Okay, great. So this is the kind of infographic data, maybe, because the result is kind of important, because that set of results leads to how you define the next steps, right? So perhaps, you know, highlight this a little bit more. And but then what does it tell you? What the maybe the hypothesis here is to, maybe there's a hypothesis somewhere. Yeah. In terms of persona, I always think, you know, I look into in persona summary is that obviously you've got the standard stuff, but I kind of like the way how if the designer has given it a story, because in my experience, presenting persona to the stakeholders, it's nice, it's easier for them to absorb if there's a story attached to this person rather than this is just 31-year-old, blah, blah, blah. Goals, needs, pain points, etc. Those are pretty mandatory, but if depending on the product, you may want to include what kind of technology, you know, level of technology familiarity of this particular user that you're targeting. So that's because I guess we're doing a, you know, cash app, a fintech product. So all of this fintech related. Interesting. Why all male? Sitemaps. Okay. Again, like James mentioned before, this is a, well, yeah, I can click and view. James, feel free to jump in at any point too.
Yeah, I really agree with your points about showing things visually. There were certainly parts earlier that I think could have been shown more visually. I also, and this was something I was going to address in the next one as well, want to call out the sense that we're like sitemap, and then there's the sitemap, right? There's an opportunity, I think, to sort of show, don't tell. Like, I would recommend you guys go watch Chip Kidd's TED Talk. Chip Kidd does these awesome book cover designs. He did the book cover design for Jurassic Park. And he's like, the first thing you learn in design school, he has a great manner of speaking, is that you're like, you can either say apple or you can show an apple, right? You can't show an apple with the word apple on it because that's treating your users like idiots. And I think this is a similar kind of thing too, where it's just like we label things, we show the thing, but we can't access the showing of the thing. The labeling of the thing doesn't tell us anything other than the fact that you've done that. And then we sort of, in the body here, show, like we describe what this thing is. So like, let's take task flow. We'll walk through of how the user might enable roundups. That just defines this. This gave a breakdown of this. Okay, but what was the outcome? I'd love to focus on learnings rather than the fact you did it, right? So here would be awesome. It's like, as this task flow illustrates, show it large. We have this key insight, which presented this outcome, right? So it's sort of like the STAR method, as I say. It's like situation, task, action, response. What happened from when this when you got prompt to the outcome? And here, I think we have a missed opportunity to not show outcomes.
Yeah, I can't agree more, James. Absolutely, 100%.
I'm gonna jump in real quick.
It's impact. Yep.
Hey, sorry, Jacqueline, you guys have such great points. Let's move on to maybe the last one with James, and then we'll get into some Q&A.
Yeah, sweet. Okay.
Cool. All right. I've picked again, and the lucky winner is Taria. I'm sorry. I'm probably mispronouncing your name. Product design thinker from San Francisco with a passion for user-centered design and crafting inclusive experiences. Love that about inclusive experiences. Previously at Wish. Cool. And we have two things here for Wish, one for IBM, and one for this thing called Parlish. Firstly, the thing that just immediately comes to mind is what a quote-unquote clean and just minimal and airy design aesthetic we have here. We see this too in the resume as well. Look, you know, it's so obvious what's going on. There's like clear and few bullet points that just describe what it is you were doing with these action verbs, which I really love. Led, visualized, you know, led, collaborated. This is, I think, ambitious for someone who is, I think, on a more junior level, having just done these internships. We're talking about the opportunity to lead processes. From ideation to engineering handoff. It shows full stack design. It shows ambition, I think, to do things beyond the seniority level that you may be at the moment. And it talks about like the impacts I think that you had, which I think is really awesome. So then diving into some of these case studies here, and again, we see a similar kind of thing where, you know, these are clear and straightforward. Let's just pick on one again. IBM Solutions Hub. I just want to call out as we saw, this is similar to the one you were just reviewing, Jacqueline, the one before, where we are showing these sort of persona cards. This shows like text and all in a like smaller than it would just maybe in text normally. I think that where we do this, when we show images, not for the purpose of like its design, but rather for the purpose of making the story more engaging, we can't ever get in the way of the story. And I'm concerned that at times we may do so here in the sense that I may struggle to read some of these things and I can't expand them. Again, just touching briefly on that as a concern. Same thing here, also potentially unreadable. It's unclear, speaking of what I was just speaking about the fact that like we go beyond just the fact that we did this thing to what we got out of it. So let's take this example, IDA, prioritization chart. Once we synthesized what we learned and felt confident in understanding our topic and users, we highlighted major user needs. I designed a prioritization chart. So it's clear what it is you did here, but I'm not at all clear with what the outcome of this thing was. Did we just sort of do it and move on? Perhaps it's here, but I'm unclear as to how this process uniquely positioned us to get these insights. Why this process? Why did that, you know, what was surprising here? I think so often we see process sort of for process's sake, and I'm almost concerned a little bit that some of these kind of things err towards that in some occasions. Overall, though, I think this is really, really cool. When we go to the final design solution, I am still a bit unclear as to what we have designed, what the point was here, and again, how we are to judge what we're seeing. I'd love for us to have seen a more of a sort of story. We're jumping into like visual design here, chose neutral shades and subtle colors to highlight different elements found on each page. I'm not sure entirely what that means. Is that a brand imperative? Does that highlight a specific thing that we want to highlight from like our interaction findings? I would draw connections between what you did specifically to a belief, a thesis you may have, or something in data that suggests that that's valuable. I also want to highlight some of these others from Wish as well. Again, love that you're showing specifically what it is you did. And then I think this is really cool, like target audience, customer seeking low price products. Like it's very apparent here what's going on. I'd note again that we're adhering to this sort of research, observe kind of, you know, structure, which in some ways I think can be great, but also in some ways we're maybe not drawing that same connection I was illustrating a bit earlier. It tells more of a story, I think, of what you did, not necessarily what is much you learned. Then we sort of define the goal. We have these kind of like wireframes as well. I see a lot of case studies, a lot of portfolios that go through wireframes like this. And sometimes I think there's a slight tendency to just effectively put into grayscale what we then see in higher fidelity. A lot of the power of wireframes is showing a lot of options. What do wireframes do? They let us go faster. They let us look at, say, just structure without worrying about things like color and stuff that may confuse us. How are we leveraging those strengths of this process method in this particular application? Or is it simply a stepping stone on the way to something that's interactive? What I think commonly occurs with more junior designers is that they have this idea in their head and they sort of go through this thing effectively just to, you know, do that process step, not to make a decision here. I'd love it if you could highlight the decision that you made as a result of the fact you did this exploration that was empowered by the fact that lower fidelity, particularly for maybe non-design stakeholders, allowed a more effective conversation, enabled you to go quicker, something around this kind of thing, right? And then like, again, we have interactive prototype and then there is you interacting with it. So like, this is again, the thing about sort of labeling. Instead, I would just, I sound like I'm nitpicking, I know, but like instead would suggest that we highlight what it is we learned or what it is we arrived at. Here, it's not just that we arrived at an interactive prototype. It's not that we arrived at a solution. We arrived at a browse experience. We arrived at a search experience. We solved the problem in this way. And then the text can sort of help us interpret what it is we're seeing here, which I think this sort of does here a little bit. And then I think that these kind of things do too. Again, I'd pay attention to sort of size and all. And just the opportunity to maybe make this a bit more engaging there by just having like autoplay. But overall, I think this is really cool. And the visual design of the overall thing makes me really confident that this person has visual design skills, yet also has a clear process with a clear structure, which particularly for more junior designers is really essential to see. So I'm really happy about that. And of course, the fact that this person is cognizant of biases in the industry and all, and is committed to the sort of inclusive design thing is a really, really positive thing for me. I am particular like this. I think it's really apparent we're talking about like this little element, right? And regardless of, you know, the actual thing, the actual learning here, we're making a real illustration of the text that's being described. Jacqueline, any other things to note?
I'm curious about the success metrics. What's under the success metrics?
That's a great call out.
Because that, I think success metrics in a real business case, it involves a lot of more of a data thing, you know?
Yeah.
It's a both a qualitative and quantitative sort of validation of whether or not this idea and feature that you've built, it's a go-to or not go-to, because that, without a well-defined success metric, there is no next steps. So I think I would personally pay more attention to write out the success metrics and think about what kind of testing you have done, what was the result, how did people, you know, react to it perhaps just think about this. For example, if you interview 8 or 10 people, and 8 people says, yeah, this looks good, much better experience than the previous version, bam, you've got a data set going 8 out of 10 users, existing users, said that this is a better experience. That alone is more powerful than it works, or like, you know, people can achieve the goals. I think it needs to have some sort of like, either it's a comparison to what's before or some sort of change.
Yeah, I know we're probably short on time on this, and I see Casey playing the music to give us up, but I just want to say one more thing on this. I completely agree, Jacqueline. And I just want to note as well, I was mentioning earlier that like I could see some ambition in like the resume to be doing all these more things. There's, I think, a competing metrics or competing goals. When you have someone that's a bit more junior who's done internships, they want to be showing that kind of more seniority. But frequently this manifests as not describing fully enough the limitations that they were working under. The narrative, I think, that happens in people's heads is, if there were limitations, it makes it seem as if I didn't have as big of an impact. But that's not so. The nature of design is that we work within limitations. We work within constraints. So if the reality of this, the success metrics is that you didn't determine these, but rather these were determined for you by the team or by more senior designers or by PMs, I think it's fine to say that those are the constraints that you were working within, or those were what your team had identified was successful. That doesn't, I think, undermine the value that you did bring.
Yeah. Yep. Go ahead, Jacqueline. Let me cut you off there.
Sorry, I just want one thing to add to it. So before anyone starts a project, think about what defines success for this project, right? After you discover what the project is and the business and the goal, whatever, those things, you go, okay, as a team, we've decided the success means the user will be, you know, 80% of the user decided to sign up to this website, or 50% of the user can successfully check out within 5 seconds. You need to somehow define these kind of metrics before you start a project, because without that, those kind of data set, it's a guidance for you to go, okay, when we're testing, we're going to come back to this definition of success to try and prove those success points. And then at the end of your project, that's how you sort of draw the full stop and rhymes back to that at the beginning of the story.
And notice everyone that Jacqueline keeps saying we, right? You can talk about what the team did. You can talk about what the overall project was, right? Nothing occurs in a vacuum. And I think that that's a strength that shows that you work with a team. As long as you're clear about what it is you did as part of this thing, and you can say that fairly briefly in the beginning, then I think you can absolutely talk about what the team overall concluded.
Well, dang, that's some good stuff. Thanks, everybody. We've got a couple questions we picked out from the crowd for a Q&A real quick. I'm going to read them out and have our mentors, reviewers answer them as they see fit. And we've got, let's see, 1 second. Okay, number one. And I'm so sorry if I butcher your name. That's just me. From Curran, how do industry professionals feel about people coming out of boot camps? Ooh.
You picked my question, dog.
I can jump in on this first. I think that nearly every designer I've ever worked with has been self-taught, has done some stuff in university, has gone to a boot camp. The design industry is so diverse that I personally think that there is no one way to learn design. And so I'm super open to any potential approach there. I had my manager's manager once, a director at one of a company, ran a comic book store. Like, that can be a real strength, especially if you're new to the industry. There's a lot of things that you think you can bring. I would say, though, that there are some things that I have just seen tend to be more likely to be vulnerabilities when it's someone who is coming from boot camp. These things tend to be, people from boot camps, in my experience, tend to adhere to processes a bit more rigidly than maybe some others. They tend to be taught a process, a machine to go through, and tend to do that machine and maybe do a little bit less of the strategy stuff behind it. That's just something I try to screen for a bit. But It absolutely is, you know, a learning process, and people are under no illusions when you're just coming out of boot camp that you're going to be doing all of those kind of things. And so, yeah, it varies so much in the individual.
Yeah. In my opinion, because I teach boot camps, and I have given recently for 2 years, I have finally gave one student 10 out of 10 for her case study. And her case study was, she taken everything that, you know, through every single important points that we mentioned. And I think there's a couple of elements. No one should ever generalize a designer whether or not they are coming from boot camp, right? So that's my thing. It really shows your first bootcamp project is never going to be your best project. That's reality, because for all of the educational institutes, it's their job to teach you all of the most commonly used methods in the industry, right? Doesn't mean, so for your bootcamp case study, you're most likely going to include all of this into your case study and go, hey, I've done this and that. Very normal. Great. Now let's move on to the next project, a self-initiated project. At this new second project that you self-initiated, it's your opportunity to go, okay, now I'm my own boss. No one's gonna tell me whether I need to go through this particular research method and that particular research method. It's up to you, based on the challenge that you throw at yourself, what type of method that you're going to use and what kind of insights that leads you to process to the next step. And that is when you're starting to exercise that muscle of being almost a strategic designer and thinker. You know, I, in my opinion, a good designer does all of these things that we've spoken about, but a great designer, you know, it's not just the user, it's the business, it's the future. You got to look at the world. All of those elements play together. So I think it is your chance after the bootcamp to really spread your wings and just have fun with all of these things that you've taken from the bootcamp and create your own, you know, music afterwards.
Excellent. Gosh, great answers. Second question from Christelle. Should our case study slide deck go more into detail or include an equal amount of information as our portfolio?
Sorry, can you repeat that one again?
Sure, yeah. Should our case study slide deck, portfolio slide deck, go more into detail or include an equal amount of information as our portfolio?
The way I interpret this question is that in many interview processes, there is a just general portfolio submission as part of the initial screen, but then later you may be invited for an onsite in which you present a particular case, and frequently these are asked for in decks. And so I think maybe this question is asking about how those kinds of walkthroughs, where it's like a 45-minute presentation, should go relative to something that's, you know, done on the web. I would note that they are different. If that's the question, then they are different audiences and different scopes of time and different degrees of investment and different stages of the process. And so to that effect, there is a value to changing the way that your presentation is a little bit to match the fact that we're dealing with like a sequential medium and you're dealing with a different kind of audience. In slide deck portfolio presentations, I tend to like to follow a format where I do one major project and then two small, like smaller bites at the end, particularly one at the end that really is wowing visually. Like, for example, I might do like an interaction design thing we had to solve. And then like, here's like, and one more thing. And then here's a fun brand thing we did as well. And that kind of thing, that structure, I think, tends to go over fairly well. Making sure, of course, you leave time for questions. I don't think it's a question of depth or complexity. I think it's a question of what story you tell. You have a limited window of time. You may need to go faster or slower. So I would focus it on like just visuals in the deck so you can support that dynamically with whatever kind of story the audience is tolerant of. Focusing on a smaller amount of decision-making than you think you have to. So I think it's the same amount of information, but maybe in a bit more depth and therefore a smaller amount of content. But it all varies, so.
Yeah.
It depends.
Depends.
It really depends.
Cool. Well, let's move on to the third question. There's a lot of plus ones on this one. If this is from Bianca. If you're already in the field and can no longer show the work you've done at your companies, how do you recommend forming a portfolio that doesn't appear so junior?
Oh, as in all the work that you're doing in the company currently, it's signed by NDA and you can't show it. Is that the...
Correct.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Bianca, thanks. Alley-oop.
Yeah. I think this is a very common challenge for many designers, right? But think about it, is that every one of us are very familiar with signing NDA, and every single hiring managers are very familiar that you're obligated to keep your work confidential. So it is not really quite a surprise. But what was the second part of the question again?
Yep. How do you go around forming a, how do you recommend forming a portfolio that doesn't appear so junior?
Right. So, okay. So I'm guessing at the stage of your career, it's kind of like you were junior, but now that you've working in this company for a long time and you're more intermediate now, but you can't show the work. If I'm you, Bianca, I would probably, make sure, of course, utilize everything that you've learned in your current company and start giving yourself self-initiated projects and fun projects, and just show, the different problem-solving skills that you have picked up through this work, your full-time work, and apply it to other cases. That's probably what I would do. But still, if your skill has improved, it doesn't matter if it's a real business case or it's a self-initiated project. It should just reflect.
I second what Jacqueline said. You can always make your own projects. But I would note that this NDA thing is as Jacqueline was saying, it's a very common concern. Something I think a lot of people don't realize is that if you disclose information that's in an NDA to a company, to people who work in a company, those people and that company can in some ways be liable. So companies are very insistent that you not disclose information to them that is under an NDA. It is not as if they want you to and, you are being pressured to. No, if you say it's under an NDA, the company will very much support you or should very much support you in adhering to that NDA. It shows that you don't adhere to that NDA if you work for them as well. So I wouldn't worry about just disclosing that it's under an NDA. That said, there's a lot of content, a lot of work you can often show, even if it is under an NDA, in the sense that you can allude to things in the general aggregate. Firstly, NDAs do not cover any information that is in public domain. If your work launched, you can say, I worked on that thing. A lot of the times you can speak about it in general or about what you learned. Like, for example, I interned at Google. They have a really strict NDA thing and some of my stuff didn't launch. I say, I learned, how to do low or no interface interactions, right? That's so general, that can mean anything. That isn't under an NDA. What I learned isn't under an NDA. The fact that it's the company's intention to sell a particular thing is under an NDA. So something just to consider.
Awesome. Awesome, guys. That's so great. I know there's a billion other questions out there, but we gotta move on. So let's jump to our signature selfie. It's about that time. If you've attended our events, we do this at the end of each one. We get a selfie of each screen, so or each group of folks. So if you'd like to feel like turning on your camera, letting us see your beautiful face, you don't have to. But we're going to go through the motions of taking selfies and be patient. There's five or six screens, I believe. Yeah. So I believe we've got somebody to take over.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much. So please, guys, put on your smiles, put on your cameras, and let's do this. We're going to go to six screens, so please be patient with me. Okay, I'm going to the first screen right now. So first screen taken now. Thank you very much. And I am going to go through the second screen. So second screen, go in now. Thank you so much. And I'm going through the third screen. So third screen going in now. Okay, thank you. And I'm going through the fourth screen, almost reaching out the sea of black screens and stuff. Thank you. I'm going through the fifth screen right now. And we're kind of getting to the last screen. And yes, that is it. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you. you know, each event, we have more and more folks joining. So selfies are always fun. So let's go ahead and jump into our next event coming up. We've got our first ever keynote launch event 2021. We're talking about you know, what we're building and launching at ADPList, and what we're looking to do together this year. That's going to be happening next Thursday, January 14th at 10 a.m. Pacific Coast time, 1 p.m. Eastern. Save it to your calendar, and we'll more details will be coming in the later this week. So keep an eye out for that on like LinkedIn and whatnot. And James's birthday is today, so we're going to sing happy birthday to him. I know. It's going to be amazing. So come off mute if you'd like. And at the count of three, everyone starts singing happy birthday. I'm not going to sing. I'll mouth it because I am terrible. But, you know, feel free to take over. Come off mute. We're going to sing James happy birthday. Ready? 3, 2, 1.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you, James.
Happy birthday, James.
Thank you, everyone. Let's give a round of applause to our mentors again for joining us and reviewing portfolios. Wish we could spend more time on this. Thank you guys so much for joining, and give yourselves a round of applause. Again, it's 2021. We made it. We're here. Let's start this year off right, guys. Let's go forward and learn from our mistakes in 2020 and not do the same crap. Thanks, everybody, for joining. Feel free to jump off the call. Have a great night, a great morning, wherever you are in the world. Love you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks, Casey. Thanks, everybody. Thank you.
Casey, you want pizza?
You know it. Bye, everybody. Again, feel free to drop off. Have a great night. Bye.
Is there a way you can save the chat? I'm checking my
vital signs, my battle. Yeah, I think I'm feeling the rhythm
inside my chest. You got it, Winona?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Hey,
Winona.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Winona, would you like to stay stay behind?
Yeah.
Great.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, guys. We don't exit the tunnel.
Yeah, you're going to get booted anyway.